Hey, MDC family, this is Bishop Roberts. I hope that you're doing well this week. We had another great Sunday service this past weekend, which was a Labor Day weekend. I know it was busy for a number of people. A lot of you were seeing family, watching some football, and hopefully having a little bit of time to relax and recreate. But it was so good to see a number of you this past Sunday as we continued our message series, which is called Our Faith, Jesus. For the past several weeks, we've been looking at who Jesus is for us as a church and who Jesus is for us as an individual. So far, we've looked at how Jesus is our Savior. He's the one that takes us out of darkness and puts us into God's light. We've looked at how Jesus is our sanctifier. Jesus repurposes us so that God can use us in His kingdom's cause. We've also looked at how Jesus is our spirit baptizer. When we begin to follow Jesus, God gives us the Holy Spirit, and that's what gives us life. It's what makes us who we are as believers. It gives us a whole new way of being in the world. We've also looked at how Jesus is our healer. Part of the work that Jesus does in the world is He brings things back together. He reverses our situations. Those who are sick become well. Those who can't walk begin to walk. Those who struggle with depression and anxiety, they're given peace. Part of what we believe that God can most certainly do is heal us. And when we're seeing people healed, when we experience healing ourselves, it gives us a glimpse of that coming time when God will make all things right. God will reverse every situation. God will heal every broken body and make things right. This past week, though, we began to look at the final aspect of who Jesus is to us as a church. We looked at how Jesus is our soon coming King. And we specifically looked at what that means by looking at a passage that comes out of 1 Corinthians chapter 15, and we looked at verses 51 through 58. And it says this, I love this, I'm gonna read this here. It says, "Listen, I tell you a mystery. We will not all sleep, but we will all be changed. In a flash, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will be changed." Changed keeps coming up over and over again in this passage. Continuing on in verse 53, it says, "For the perishable must clothe itself with the imperishable, and the mortal with immortality. When the perishable has been clothed with the imperishable, and the mortal with immortality, then the saying that is written will come true. Death has been swallowed up in victory." But the question is, whose victory? And we'll get to that. In verse 55, it continues on, repeating the words of Hosea, the prophet, who had told people long ago that there's a time coming where death is going to be swallowed up in victory. Verse 55 recounts Hosea's words, "Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God. He gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ." So this victory that you and I have as believers, it's not something that we do on our own. It's not as if we acquire superhuman powers and somehow we're able to deal with death and the consequences of death on our own, but rather we are given a victory through Jesus Christ. We are given a victory through God's work in our life. Verse 58 continues on. And Paul is basically saying, in light of the fact that death and disease is eventually defeated and it's not victorious and God's victorious, Paul says, "Therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, stand firm. Let nothing move you. Always give yourselves fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain." Paul is saying that death is not victorious. Death loses. For those of us who are in Christ, death loses. And because death loses, we can stand firm in what God has called us to do. So the simple point that we drew out of this passage that I think is so relevant to our circumstances that we walk through as believers is this. You and I, we win because Jesus wins. We win because Jesus wins. Because Jesus defeats death and Jesus has a victory over death and the resurrection, you and I, by following Jesus, we get to participate in Jesus's victory. We win because Jesus wins. So we need to remember, number one, that because Jesus wins, God will prepare us for the victory that he intends for us to have. God, through his Spirit, he will change us, and he will prepare us for that higher life that he is calling us to. He is calling us to a higher life and to live victoriously. And because God is calling us to do that, he will prepare us to live in that victory. Number two, we have to remember that life has the final word because death has lost its power. You know, there's death all around us. There's struggles all around us. We go through things that are challenging. But friends, I hope that you're encouraged with the fact that this morning, death does not have the final word. Life has the final word because of what Jesus Christ has done. And finally, and this is important, we should live like winners. We should live like people who know that the victory is coming. Now, that's why we can stand firm. When Paul says stand firm, he's not saying that life will never be scary and there won't be challenges. But what he's saying is you can stand firm because you know how the story ends. There's no ambiguity about what's going to happen on the end. There's no question of whether or not God is going to be victorious. There's no question of, you know, whether or not there will be a day that comes that the brokenness of our world will be healed. We know that God wins, so therefore you and I should live as winners. We are going to end our series that we've been in over the past several weeks this coming Sunday. So I invite you to come out. We're going to dig into who Jesus is once again and begin to understand what that then specifically means for the community that is gathered around this person that we call Jesus, this one who comes in and transforms the world in a radical way. So I invite you to come out this upcoming Sunday. I want to remind everyone that this Sunday is a Friends and Family Sunday. So please, please come out. We would love to see you. Bring your friends, bring your family, bring your cousins, next door neighbors. We're going to have a wonderful time of fellowshipping and getting to know one another. We especially invite those of you who we have not seen in a while. I know that the pandemic has caused many of us to remain at home for safety reasons, which are completely understandable. We do invite you to come in person. For this special Sunday, we're going to have food. I have secured the best barbecue in Bartow, is what I have heard, word on the street. So we will have some plates for you all to take home after church, and we're going to have a wonderful time. Also, on September 18th, we are going to be having two services. So we will have our regular Sunday morning service at 10:30 a.m., but then at 5 p.m., we are going to have a time of district fellowship with our sister church, the Upper Room Church of God, and Bishop James Matthew Andrews from Lakeland, Florida. So you're not going to want to miss that. That's going to be a powerful service and time of equipping and empowerment and encouragement. Well, as always, we are praying for you. I am excited about what God is doing at New Beginnings Church in Bartow. I believe that God is going to give us a new beginning, and we are going to see people saved, sanctified, and find healing through our church family. So I invite you, come on out, be a part of what is going on at New Beginnings Church, NBC Bartow. We are excited for what the Spirit is doing. Well, I hope to see you this upcoming Sunday at Friends and Family Sunday, 10:30 a.m. As always, South 6th Avenue, Wabash in Bartow, Florida. Blessings to you and have a wonderful day.